Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning. Welcome to St. Peter's Lutheran Church on this Lord's Day. Welcome, guest and member, to the best hour of our week. Please take note of all the announcements in your bulletin. This week, tomorrow, there's worship and music meeting at 10 a.m. Tuesday, choir practice at 6:30. Wednesday, quilting and Bible study at 9 a.m. Later that day at 5:30, the Lenten Supper is at 5:30 and worship at 7. On Thursday, I'm leaving town. I'm going out to Montana to be at the wedding of a friend. And so Pastor Greer from First Lutheran in Audubon is on call if there are any emergencies. And next Sunday, the confirmation youth will be leading the worship. They've been working hard getting ready for it. And so I wish I could be here to be part of it, but I know they will do an excellent job. We're still collecting filled plastic Easter eggs for the egg hunt that will be held for the children on Easter morning. So if you're able to bring some Easter eggs to me, bring those to me or to the church office before Easter morning. Now, you might recognize this church that's on the front cover of Living Lutheran magazine this month. St. Peter's Lutheran Church is on the front of Living Lutheran, and this is a national magazine that goes out to all. This is a publication of the ELCA. And so they had called last month to do an interview. They had found us on Facebook, and I knew they were going to put a couple pictures in the article, but I didn't know we were going to be on the cover. So it's kind of cool that we're on the cover of this magazine. There's a couple blurbs about that I talk about how wonderful you all are in the article. But if you would like to read the article, there's a couple copies out there on the table. Otherwise, livinglutheran.org, you can read the whole magazine online there, or you can also order a copy as well. Very exciting. Are there other announcements this morning? Well, then please stand as we begin worship. We gather this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's join in singing. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing.
Thank you.
Worship continues on page 203 at the front part of your hymnal. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The day is printed on your celebrate insert. Let's pray this prayer together. Almighty God, your Son came into the world to free us all from sin and death. Breathe upon us the power of your Spirit, that we may be raised to new life in Christ and serve you in righteousness all your days. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
The first reading is from Ezekiel chapter 37, verses 1 through 14. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to those bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you. And you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I had been commanded. And as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy, and say to them, thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, I will put my spirits within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord. The Psalms, chapter 130, will read responsively. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord.
O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication.
If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand? I wait for you, O Lord, my soul waits. In your word is my hope.
My soul waits for the Lord, more than those who keep watch for the morning, more than those who keep watch for the morning.
O Israel, wait for the Lord, for with the Lord there is a steadfast love, and the Lord there is plenty, plenteous redemption. The second reading is Romans chapter 8, verses 6 through 11. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's laws. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the spirit. Since the Spirit of God dwells in you now. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to you, more to your mortal bodies, also through the Spirit that dwells in you.
Please stand. The Holy Gospel for this Lord's Day is from the 11th chapter of John.
Glory to you, Lord.
And I'm going to have you be seated, because once again we have a very long gospel, and so you maybe notice that in your bulletin there is a separate sheet where we've divided the gospel into parts, and wherever it says congregation in bold letters, that's all of you. Please join in that line together. And then there's others who I've asked to read the other parts. And so we will share in the gospel together in this way today. A man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. This was the same Mary who massaged the Lord's feet with aromatic oils and then wiped them with her hair. It was her brother Lazarus who was sick. So the sisters sent word to Jesus.
This sickness is not fatal. It will become an occasion to show God's glory by glorifying God's Son.
Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. But oddly, when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed on where he was for 2 more days. And after the 2 days, he said to his disciples,
"Let's go back to Judea."
"Rabbi, you can't do that. The Jews are out to kill you, and they're going back."
Walking at night, he might very well stumble because he can't see where he's going. Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep. I'm going to wake him up.
Master, he's not asleep. Give him a good rest and wake up feeling fine.
Jesus was talking about death, while his disciples thought he was talking about taking a nap.
You're about to be given new grounds for believing. Now, let's go to him.
Come along. We might as well die with him.
When Jesus finally got there, he found Lazarus already 4 days dead. Bethany was near Jerusalem, only a couple of miles away, and many of the Jews were visiting Martha and Mary, sympathizing with them over their brother. Martha heard Jesus was coming and went out to meet him. Mary remained in the house.
Master, if you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Even now, I know that whatever you ask God, he will give you.
Your brother will be raised up.
I know that he will be raised up in the resurrection at the end of time.
You don't have to wait for the end. I am right now, resurrection of life. The one who believes in me, even though he or she dies, will live. And everyone who believes in me does not ultimately die at all. Do you believe this?
Yes, Master. All along I have believed that you are the Messiah, the Son of God who comes into the world.
After saying this, she went to her sister Mary and whispered in her ear. The moment she heard this, she jumped and ran out to him. Jesus had not yet entered the town, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When her sympathizing Jewish friends saw Mary run off, they followed her, thinking she was on her way to the tomb to weep there. Mary came to where Jesus was waiting and fell at his feet. When Jesus saw her sobbing, and the Jews with her sobbing, a deep anger welled up within him. He said, "Where did you put him?"
"Master."
Now Jesus wept. Others among them said, "Well, if he loved him so much, why didn't he do something to keep him from dying? After all, he opened the eyes of the blind man." Then Jesus, the anger again welling up within him, arrived at the tomb. It was a simple cave in the hillside with a slab of stone laid against it.
"Remove the stone."
"Master, by this time there is a stench. He's been dead 4 days."
"Didn't I tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? Go ahead and take away the stone."
They removed the stone. Jesus raised his eyes to heaven and prayed. Then he shouted,
"Lazarus, come out."
And he came out, a cadaver, wrapped from head to toe, and with a kerchief over his face.
"Unwrap him and let him loose."
That was a turnaround for many of the Jews who were with Mary. They saw what Jesus did and believed him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
Let's confess our faith. We use the words of the Apostles' Creed. It's on page 105. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I invite the children to come forward for the youth message. Come on down. Good morning. Good morning. Hello. We've got a few of you here today. It's nice to see you, as always. Hi. Hello. How's your weekend going so far? Good. Now, did you hear that Bible story that we all read together? That was kind of cool, wasn't it? Everybody did a good job reading their parts, and we all had a part in it. So it was a story about a man who had died. Did you catch the name of the man that died? Lazarus, yes. And his sisters were Mary and Martha. Yep. And so they called for Jesus to come. He didn't come right away. But after a couple of days, he came. And when he got to the place where Lazarus was, there's the shortest verse in the Bible that takes place right at this part of the story. Do you know what that shortest verse of the Bible is? Yeah? No, not quite. Does anyone know what the shortest verse? Jesus wept. What does that mean? He wept. Yeah, do you know? No? It's good I brought it up. Do you know what it means to weep? To cry, yes. So it said Jesus cried. And why was he crying? Yeah? He loved Lazarus. Yeah, he was sad. Lazarus had died, and so Jesus was sad. And I always think that's amazing, that to know that Jesus, who is God, cried. Do you ever cry? Have you ever cried? Yeah. Have you guys ever cried? Yeah. It's sometimes things hurt, sometimes bad things happen, and we cry. And God says, you know, it's okay to cry. Don't ever let anyone tell you it's not okay to cry, because that's one of the ways that we heal from the things that hurt us.
And things to remember, things that happen.
Things that happen, yeah, things happen. We never know what's going to happen. But sometimes those tears can be healing things. And sometimes one of the best things we can do when other people are hurting is just to go sit with them, maybe even cry with them. And so today, so you remember that, because I think it's important. In our world, we talk so much about being strong and about how important it is to, you know, pull yourselves up by your bootstraps and be strong and all these things. But what am I giving you right now? I'm giving you tissues because I want you to remember it's okay to cry too. And if you ever doubt that, take a look at Jesus, because Jesus did too. Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for the ways that you are with us through all of the joy and the muck and the mud of life. God, I pray for these kids that you be with them, surround them with your comfort and peace always, and help them know they are loved by you, precious beyond measure. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. There is a treat if you want one on your way back. Thank you for coming up. Did you leave your tissues? There you go.
Can I have your tissue?
The Lord be with you. In the late summer of 1996, I was 26 years old, and I packed up my car and I headed to Wyoming for an internship at a church there. It was just me and a pile of cassette tapes and my boombox next to me on the seat as I drove across the prairie for my home for the next year. And I arrived on a cool August Saturday evening where I met up with a member of the church who took me over to the house where I was to live. It was a half of a townhouse. She dropped the key in my hand and she said brightly, "See you tomorrow morning." And she left me alone there. And even with the sound of the traffic outside, it felt like I had never been in a quieter place in my whole life. The neighbor kids, they who lived in the other half of the townhouse, they rang my doorbell shortly after that. And I opened the door and they looked at me hopefully and they said, "Do you have any kids?" I said, "No." And they said, "Oh." And they walked away. And I thought, welcome to Wyoming. I began to unload my car and get settled in my house. And even though I was nervous, you know, I was excited too. I was determined it was going to be a good year. I was going to learn a lot. Even being in this place where I didn't know a soul, it was going to be a time fruitful of new beginnings and learning. And over the next days and weeks, I got to know the congregation, and they were lovely, very nice people. There was about one other single person in town, and he was the Presbyterian minister, and so we would spend time going out for coffee and to movies. I was staying busy and I was productive. I was doing my best and things would have been looking really pretty good right about then, except for one large looming problem that my internship supervisor, pastor, didn't think I was doing a very good job at all. Within days of my arrival, he began to come into my office each morning with a list of the ways that I was failing miserably. The way I preached, not good. The way I taught, sorely lacking. The way I dressed, I looked too female. My personality too quiet. And so each day I began to dread going to work. I expected to hear more criticism. And so being the dutifully obedient girl I was brought up to be, I tried every way to fit myself into the mold of the pastor that he wanted me to be. I spent each day trying so hard, but it was never good enough. And at a time in my life when what I needed was a little encouragement for the gifts I did have, what I got was this gouging of my spirit each day and telling me all the gifts I did not have. By the end of the first month, he sat down in my office across the desk from me, shaking his head, and he said, "Ruth, you don't have what it takes to be a pastor." He said, "I wish you hadn't come here." He said this to me, and I absorbed all of it like a sponge. All this criticism and anger, and I thought, well, he must be right, you know. He knows stuff. He's a pastor. He's been doing this a while. What do I know? And my spirits began to sink lower and lower. And the weeks ticked by, and I grew more miserable. The thought of being there for a whole year nearly brought me to despair. After a few months of this, my office phone rang one bleak morning. It was my hometown pastor. He had run it into my mom at the bank in Henning, who told him about what a bad experience I was having, how bad I was feeling. And God bless him, but he said, "Ruth, you know you don't have to stay there." And he said some other stuff too, but that was what I heard. He said, "Ruth, you know you don't have to stay there." And that had honestly never occurred to me, that I could leave, that I could refuse to be told that I was garbage, that I could shake the dust from my feet and I could go. And that same day I called the seminary and I finally told them how awful it had been. The office that had set up that internship, I had worked in that office, and so they knew me there. They knew I wasn't bluffing. And so they said the next week someone would be out there to help us work things out. But that night, as I sat in my half of a townhouse, I knew that working things out was not what I wanted. I didn't want one more minute of that pastor's influence in my life. I was going to leave. I was going to leave first thing in the morning. And I didn't know what I was going to do. I didn't know where I was going to go. I didn't have a foggiest clue, except I was going to leave seminary and I was getting the heck out of Wyoming. And it was equal parts liberating and crushingly sad as I began packing up my car that night, ready to leave at first light. I felt like I was setting myself free, but I also felt like I was letting God down. The whole drive, as I left Wyoming that next morning, I kept saying over and over, "I'm sorry, God. I'm sorry, God." I said goodbye to no one. And when I tell this story, I always say it's the only bridge I ever burned. I used to feel a lot of shame about that story. I saw it as a failure, as my failure, that if I were stronger, I would have stayed and I would have toughed it out. I would have stood up to that bully internship supervisor and I would have fought for my place there. But now what I know is that it's good that I left when I did, to preserve whatever gentleness I still had in me. As it was, it took me 6 months to return to seminary, to begin to believe that maybe, just maybe, that one awful pastor in Wyoming shouldn't have the last say in who I am and who I was going to be. Now, the reason I tell this story is because I want to tell you about how I returned, how I came back to life after that. Because it was one of the darkest times I'd ever known. And I can tell you about it because I know you have been there in your own ways. We all know our times in the valley of the dry bones. How I came back to life was this. A friend let me sleep in her spare bedroom while I tried to figure out what else in the world I could do with my life. How I came back to life was this. Another friend who helped me find a job, she would bring me a cold Diet Coke and she would place it on my desk each morning. She knew I was so sad I could hardly speak, and so she would just bring me this simple little gift each day. Oh, God.
It's happened to have some today.
Thank you. So sweet. How I came back to life was this. Countless people, my friends, pastors, professors, my family kept checking in with me, encouraging me, not to do anything in particular, but just to let me know I was okay, I was loved, I was held. And how I came back to life was this. That winter I got a job in a bookstore and I began dating this long-haired opera singer who worked with me there. And he was decidedly not Christian. In fact, he called himself a pagan. But we would spend hours talking about faith and God and the church, hours and hours. And one might think that spending oodles of time talking about God with your pagan boyfriend might not bring you back to seminary. But it was precisely what brought me back. God works how God works. And suddenly, I had the energy to try again, the belief that I could. And while my pagan boyfriend and I didn't make it all the way through seminary, he bought me this stole during seminary that I still wear. And he couldn't have been more proud of me on my ordination day. We're still good friends. God worked through that relationship and so many others during that time to heal me, to get me headed in the direction I needed to go again. So as Martin Luther would say, what does this mean? Well, at Bible study on Wednesday, we talked about the story of the dry bones and how God breathed life into the bones and they lived. And a discussion question that morning was, what kinds of situations do people face where they feel despair and they feel like dry, dead bones? And how might God's Spirit bring life again? And the stories people told were beautiful and awful and meaningful all at the same time. And I marveled at how we all understand at our core what it means to be in the valley of dry bones. But thank God, we also understand what it means to have that breath of life, the Spirit fill us again. What does this mean? I heard recently that the road to Easter, it always runs through a graveyard. We don't get to Easter morning without first going through Good Friday. And I can't tell you why times of devastation come. But I do know that when we feel the ease and the laughter and the joy return after those times, we catch a glimpse of the resurrection. And I'm thankful for that. What does this mean? It means be there for each other. It means know that God is with you, even in your darkest, driest, most desolate place. It means wait patiently for the Spirit. It means don't expect the Spirit to come in any certain way or certain time. But trust that it will come. It always does. In fact, it is here right now. And so I pray that the Holy Spirit fills you full today and you will know how precious and loved you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We decided to change the hymn. It is no longer whatever hymn it says in your bulletin now. We're singing hymn 396, Spirit of Gentleness. 396.
Thank you.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this to remember me." We pray the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The table is ready. Everyone is welcome. You may be seated. stand for the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you, be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We close with In the Garden. It's on one of your inserts. In peace and serve the Lord.